Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 6, Knowledge Graphs. In this section of the lecture, we will talk about linked data and the linked data principles. In the previous section of the lecture, you have already heard about the web of data. And the web of data makes use of linked data. So all of these data sets that constitute the web of data are interlinked, and they are following the so-called linked data principles, and thereby, if they are freely publicly available, they are also linked open data, LOD. Linked open data is also publicly available data structured via RDF, so the resource description framework that we've also heard about in the previous section of the lecture, and all of the data can be identified via URI and it's accessible via HTTP. So there is a standard interface to do that. And the linked data principles, they define this standardized interface. Linked data, however, the name comes from, they link to other data and other data sets via URIs. And this, of course, is the reason why they are creating then here a huge network. During the last count, which was in 2017, quite a while ago, they counted roughly 10,000 huge data sets containing around 150 billion facts and 800 million links among them. So this is already something what you can work with. Okay, let's go to a specific example. One of the first prominent use cases of linked data of semantic web technologies actually was the website of the BBC. They had the problem that, of course, on their website, they wanted to report the program. And in their program, if, for example, a specific artist was featured or was currently playing on the radio, of course, they wanted to have current, contemporary information about the artist, which means what are, let's say, the current releases, the newest releases, when are concerts and stuff like that. So this is lots of information, considering that BBC provides lots of different kind of programs. And therefore, of course, if they want to maintain these kind of pages, if they want to do it in a manual way, of course, then they have to hire a staff of web developers who constantly look up the artists and what's going on about the artists and then updating the web pages, which is a huge effort. And therefore they were looking for some means to automate that process because, you know, the data about the artist is also published in other places. Like here, for example, we have here DBpedia, we have MusicBrainz, Discogs, Last.fm. So these are all kind of data sets which are providing, if possible, latest information in linked data format about exactly the things that BBC was interested in. Okay, but before we go deeper into examples like that, let's have a look at the traditional web. In the traditional web, if you want to access data, it might be available at some website, which means to get access to the data, you always have to take the way over the web server. And behind the web server, there is then a database, and the database communicates with the web server with a different kind of, let's say, interface. Which of course differs from the web interface that the browser and the web server interact with, which is HTTP on the one hand side and probably something like JDBC on the other side between the web server and the remote database. However, each single database that might be connected to a web server offers for, let's say, access from outside kind of an API. So a programming interface. And the point is that, of course, these APIs that are used here for different websites, let's say you have an API to access, let's say, eBay, and you have another API to access, let's say, the Google search results and stuff like that. Point is you can't use the same one because, you know, all of these services, they are using proprietary, which means different APIs. However, you can combine them in a huge mashup application that accesses different kind of services. But as soon as one of these services changes its API definition so that data is delivered in another way, if they are changing something, you have to completely also change the programming of your mashup. And this, of course, is a huge mashup. It's a huge effort. So what follows usually was there that in the traditional web, all of these independent databases out there that were, however, connected to the web, but they became somehow like small data islands. So data then was locked up in these small data islands, and other applications did not have direct access to this data. So of course, let's say your e-commerce or your e-commerce shop usually doesn't have direct access to the Google search index and stuff like that. So we can't access another a database. The only way how to do that is, of course, using these kind of APIs. The APIs are proprietary, and then, of course, maintaining APIs over a long time might cause lots of maintenance costs. However, if you want to get rid of this kind of closed data islands and connect everything together, you have to apply linked data technology to publish your data on the web somehow directly, that it's accessible really via the web protocol, via HTTP. And then you can also draw connections from one data source to another data source. And to use this, let's say, simplified generic API that is already defined by the generic web protocols, HTTP, for example, and the URI to access stuff, these principles are laid down then in the linked data principles. And the way how data is delivered, it's always in the same format. It's in RDF, which is a rather generic format. So you don't have to know exactly the structure of a table if you access a table on a database. You get back generic RDF data and you get the meaning of, you know, the single data points you get there from the data itself. This is the way how linked data really works. To sum it up, there are the linked data principles. Number one, if we want to identify things on the web, we are using URIs, uniform resource identifiers. So all of our data fields that previously have resided in some database, they will become accessible. So there will be fine granular access. Everything gets a URI. Furthermore, these URIs, as long as they are publicly available, you can access them via HTTP so that people can really look up these names that you have defined. And of course, if you look it up, these URIs should provide meaningful information in terms, so if a human looks it up, then you get some HTML code. If a machine looks it up, then we get useful information by using the web standards like RDF or Sparkle. This is linked data principle number three. And most of all, to enable discovery, the data that you have put on the web will be linked to other data on the web so that you can really then follow connections, find connections, and foster explorability on the web. So these four principles are the linked data principles, which are really essential for the web of data. So looking at the BBC website and seeing what's the benefit of using linked data over the traditional way is, of course, that the information now is dynamically aggregated from external available sources like Wikipedia, MusicBrainz, Last.fm, or Discogs. And of course, this data is not simply taken from those websites via screen scraping. So you could, of course, do this, simply read what's on the screen, what's in the HTML, and try to find out, okay, what is the data that I need? But of course, if the structure of the website is changed, then your screen scraping mechanism won't work anymore. The other thing is, you also don't need a specialized API to access one of those services. You simply use the linked data API, which works for all, which means this is a generic API, not directly telling you which column to access, but what you get back there is generic RDF that will be interpreted then by your application. The data that you get back is available as linked open data, so it's formatted usually based on RDF, and you get access to it via a simple HTTP request, which means this is port 80. Sometimes APIs often, let's say, are connected or have to be connected to web services which are not using the standard regular web port 80, but some other port, and then probably your company firewall will prevent you from using that service, or you have to explicitly configure your firewall that this port will be reachable. So this problem you don't have by using linked open data, because you are using the web standard and the web standard port. The most, of course, obvious benefit is that if you have integrated these services and, let's say, Sparkle queries, getting the data from these services, putting them into templates that you have defined on your own website, then this data that you grab there will always be up to date without manual interaction. And this, of course, is a huge, let's say, maintenance benefit, because you don't have to always take care to update this information, so it will be updated by itself. So this is the huge benefit of making use of linked data and the web of data. Okay, so far so good. So we will continue in the lecture then by looking at all of the standards we have to obey in the web of data. And the first thing is we want to talk about URLs and URIs, which means we want to talk about how to identify and access things in the semantic web.